Native people, Native culture, Native knowledge. Hi, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you award-winning Heartbeat Alaska.
Bringing you national and international Native news, this is award-winning Heartbeat Alaska, the premier Native voice in Native programming.
There's a heartbeat loud as thunder, revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool?
Now, with Heartbeat Alaska, here's Jeannie Green.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native News and Native Entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. Hello to our viewers in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Glad to have you with us. Hello to our viewers on the East Coast. Hello, Mashantucket, Pequot, and hello, Seminole Tribe. Heartbeat Alaska, Native News just for you. And just for you today, we have a special program. It's called the Heartbeat Alaska Sports Edition. Introducing Heartbeat Alaska Native Sportscaster, Kevin Demientieff. Here he is now with a report from the Iditarod Trail.
Thank you, Jeannie, and hello to everybody out there. This is Kevin Demientieff with the new sports edition on Heartbeat Alaska, where we'll be covering Native sports throughout the state of Alaska. Today we're in Ruby, Alaska, the halfway point of the Iditarod Sled Dog Race, where we'll be catching up with Joe Garnie, Mike Williams, Ramey Brooks, and John Baker. It's been called the last great race on Earth. The Iditarod Trail became a life-saving highway for epidemic-stricken Nome, where an outbreak of diphtheria threatened the lives of many residents. The first official Iditarod sled dog race was run in 1973. This race cannot be compared to any other competitive event in the world. Racing more than 1,050 miles of the roughest and yet most beautiful terrain that God has ever created. The Iditarod is a race where heroes were made and legends were born. This year, 63 teams of the finest racing dogs and their mushers left Anchorage on their quest for Iditarod fame. Five of these mushers are Alaska natives. We had an opportunity to talk to some of our own heroes and legends at the halfway checkpoint in Ruby, Alaska. Joe, you're back after a four-year layoff, and you said you wanted to see if you still enjoy the Iditarod race.
Oh yeah, I'm really actually enjoying it. I didn't enjoy the start of it. Right at the beginning, I had, well, like you say, I had that absence in my equipment was so terrible. I mean, don't get me wrong, it was a nice sled and everything, and I'm really thankful to the guy to loan it to me, but man, it was a tank compared to anything anybody was running. I mean, it was three times the sled as far as weight goes.
Is that the sled over there?
No, that's a nice sled now. Oh. I had to pick that up in McGrath, but I had to drag this tub all the way there.
I read something about where you wanted to see if your dogs were multifaceted. I know you use them to haul wood and do some of the work and oil and stuff like that. You wanted to see if they could still run the race. How do you feel they've been performing?
I thought they were as good as anybody got out here. And due to a few minor mistakes and this and that, I would be right there with this top end bunch. Number one, having the proper equipment in the start. And me not making like rookie mistakes.
Dogs look pretty tired here. Are they just not used to running this long of a race, or are they...
Well, what's got these dogs is, do you know what the temperature have been since day one?
It's been warm. It's been
way warm, even at nights. These dogs are from Teller. That's north of Nome.
Good. So we can expect to see you in the future?
You can expect to see me in the future just on fire.
All right.
Be right there and run.
That's exciting.
84-year-old Robert Vent is an Athabasca native from Hooslea, who ran the first Iditarod race in 1973. He finished second with a time of 21 days and 5 dogs in harness.
What the middle got away, I went over to see him. I had snow globe. Nobody had dogs.
The snow just came in that time. It ruined everything. Ruined all our dogs. They sold them and everything, see? Then I picked up a few around the village. I didn't have not one dog of my own. I picked up a few around the village. But it was too late to get them trained up hard enough or tough enough for the Iditarod. Anyway, okay, everything was all right. My dog got in the fight. I got one dog bit right in the joint. Well, he made one day, and that was it. I had to leave him behind. By golly, when I got there, I had to leave five dogs altogether with the two. With them, see, that's five altogether. I had six dogs left now. So I went over the divide, and we had to go through Ptarmigan Pass. Let's go up the pass and hit the southward way up there, see. It was kind of dangerous to go through there, going through the main trail, where they go now. And we camped there. George Sattler was there. He had his dog's feet were going on the bum, but he took off the next morning, and I took off behind him. I caught him up around Bear Creek somewhere over there, and I passed him. Now I'm ahead. Pretty nice. We camped there. I had no dog feet. They didn't dump no frickies around there. I would keep a bunch in my sleigh, you see. But I ran out. But he had some old moose meat hanging up in the, he shot last fall hanging up, and the crows got to it, and he didn't want it, so he said, you can have it. So I cut that down, and I just threw it to my dog, just a bowl. The crows eat all the best stuff off of the ready. Out in the cross, I guess they call it, in Oka River. We made camp there, and we went out, we were going towards Poor Man, but we got lost, and we made a big circle. And we came back to our camp, same camp that night. We camped there 2 nights. Oh, man. I got to dog's leader first. I was the first team in there with 26 or some teams behind there, with big teams. Well, they all say you want to win the race. They tell me that a little too fast. I know I ain't going to win no race because those guys, they know what they're doing too. And much the next morning, we started for Unicleet. Quite a long distance. Anyway, I was hooking up my dog, and Dick come by. He hooked him behind me somewhere, and he come by me. Well, I'll see you in home, I told him. He turned back, looked at me. You know what, Bob? What? My dog ate half a beaver apiece last night. He said, right. And he kept it going. I wish mine had that, but I couldn't get it. Next day, my dog's a little stiff, but anyway, I had to go. I made it down to Shaktulik. Next day, to Koyuk. Next day, halfway down to Koyuk, and I was going to make Koyuk that same day. But I had to camp out on account of storm. Couldn't see the trail, couldn't see nothing. Man, that's a bad place out there when it's dark. See, the black all over. Can't see nothing. Gosh, in the storm. But I made it to a fish camp there, and I camped there. And Dan Seabee was supposed to be there too. Next day we made it to Elm, and then we kept going over to Elm, Solomon, Gollivan, and then the White Mountain. We camped there. I camped there. And that's when I hear on the radio, Dick Wilmark just got in to know him. You had them big dogs, and I guess they liked that open country, and they really took off, you know. Well, I made it down to Nome next day. I was a pretty weak man that time. Gosh. Yeah, that was it. 21 days. 21 days, yeah. He made it 20.
Mike Williams, another Alaska native, is in his fifth consecutive race, dedicating his time and efforts to sobriety for our people.
How many times has this been for you in the Iditarod?
This is my fifth year running for sobriety, and I've been doing this every year because I'm at war with alcohol, because it brought too many tragic things. I lost a lot, all my brothers, and and a lot of relatives to alcohol accidental deaths, and I'm at total war with it, against it, and it's people's choice, but I think those choices need to be made, educated choices. I just strongly feel that we should take care of our children, and our children deserve the best. You know, they don't need to be running away or sleeping at other people's homes. They have to be fed and educated. So I've been fighting this thing for years, and I ain't gonna quit.
Yeah.
There's sobriety dances now in the villages. There's sobriety parades going on in Shaktula. People are getting sober here in Ruby. People are getting testimonials in Nikolai, and testimonials on the Iditarod Trail speaks for itself. Akiak, I love all of you, and I miss all of you, and I just can't wait till I get this thing over with and be back to Akiak, because my heart's there, and Akiak is the best place to be. Well, right now the best place is Nome, so I'm heading there.
The Yukon Fox, Emmitt Peters, won the Iditarod race in 1975, beating the old record by an unheard of 6 days, finishing with a time of 14 days, 14 hours, 43 minutes, and 15 seconds.
Well, they got a lot of dogs, and they years ago they had a thick coat, you know, the fur on the dogs. They had longer hair, and nowadays they got real short hair. They bred the dogs down where it's just like they got hardly any fur on them. And you have to, you can see that. They got to put the blankets on them nowadays and the coat on them so to keep them warm so they won't freeze when they come to a checkpoint. They sweat lots and they cool off in a hurry. There's no protection, no insulation. They have to put a lot of hay in there and cover them up. And that's, years ago, we never had to worry about that. We used the spruce browse off the trees and used that for our bedding for the dogs. But now they ship a bale of hay to every checkpoint for each mushroom. So it's quite a change there. Well, one thing for sure, it'll keep the young people out of mischief. It'll keep them occupied and trying to set a goal for themselves or try to make a name for themselves, keep busy all the time, stay out of trouble, and it keep them well occupied, like feeding time and training time and whatever, you know, it takes to be a good dog musher. And I think it's good sports, it's good clean sports. And I would like to see a lot of them do it, you know, encourage. And I'm trying to encourage my boys, one of my boys, how to try to take after his dad and try to learn something about dogs. You know. But it takes time.
What are the chances of seeing Emmitt Peters run the race again?
I don't think so. It's got to be, the price got to be right.
There you go.
I think Johnny Baker is well financed in one way, and then he loved the sports in the other way. He grew up that way, and his family and is always competitive in sports, and he just happened to be one of the family that loved dogs, and he has proven it to us in the last 2 years, because he jumped from a rookie of the year. 20th place or something like that, I forgot, all the way to 11th spot last year. And he showed everybody that he's determined to get out there and prove to the world that he's treating his dogs well and train them good and feed them well. So So it proved to us that he's an outstanding musher. And we like to see that. Every native along the Yukon or interior of Alaska, they get a chance to prove themselves.
Running his third race from Kotzebue, John Baker has drawn a lot of attention by being first into Ruby, winning the halfway prize money and a 7-course meal. In John's last two races, he has finished 11th, and this year he has moved into the top 5. John Baker has proven that he is a contender for the championship. John, we understand that you've had a 24-hour layover here in Ruby, Alaska. How are your dogs feeling?
The dogs are feeling better than they've felt the whole race, so I'm looking forward to the next part of the race.
With your training that you've had on the coast in the Kotzebue area, do you think that's going to be an advantage when you get to Unalakleet?
Not the training, but the way the dogs are feeling will definitely be an advantage, yeah.
We also understand that we got a sports card here and that you're carrying some information for the children of Kotzebue. Could you tell us about that?
Oh, it's a banner that all the people in the Kotzebue Elementary signed. The banner says Kotzebue Elementary School and John Baker are committed to excellence, so everybody signed it.
Also, you've came in first here. You're the first one to check in, and congratulations on that. And how do you feel about the rest of the race from here on out?
Well, if we keep doing what we've been doing, I think the race will fall into itself. We're really in a good position. I'm satisfied with the position, so we'll just have to see how the dogs are feeling now when we leave.
And we've noticed from talking to people here in town that this is very unusual warm weather. Is that going to be a factor in the race for you?
It has been up to this point. We're going to be running in the middle of the night now, so by morning we'll be in much colder weather, so it'll be all right.
Is there anything that you'd like to say to the people of Kotzebue?
No, besides thank you to the whole area and let everybody know that everything is going good, and I'll see them soon.
It's John Baker running the Iditarod Trail here in beautiful downtown Ruby, the halfway point of the Iditarod Trail. John Baker has now left Ruby, Alaska, and is on his way to Nome, Alaska, currently in 9th place. I'm Kevin Demientieff with photographer John Crabb. Now back to Jeannie and more of the show.
Thanks a lot, Kevin. John Crabb and Kevin Demientieff travel from the Iditarod Trail to Fairbanks, Alaska. And you may be wondering what's happening to Heartbeat Alaska. Well, this program is special. We're introducing the Heartbeat Alaska Sports Edition, a segment that'll be aired weekly from now on in Heartbeat Alaska. No, it won't be the entire program like this one, but you can look forward to more sports broadcasting like this. John Crabb and Kevin Demientieff heading to Fairbanks, Alaska for an all-native basketball championship game.
I think we all want to have good schools and we want to have good jobs.
Mike Williams, Iditarod contestant, knows that American Seafoods is helping to make those dreams a reality.
With the American Seafoods Company, I noticed they are recruiting in rural Alaska. I think it has done a lot of positive things for our young people. If they're building a home, then they have that opportunity.
American Seafoods Company, bringing jobs for our future.
Hello everybody out there, this is Kevin Demientieff with Heartbeat Alaska Sports Edition. Today I'm with Cliff Joseph of the Golden Heart Alaska Native Sports Association. And today we're covering his tournament here in Fairbanks, Alaska. When did your tournament begin, Cliff?
I think it originally started in 1979 before I even got up here, but I took over in 1991 and we incorporated a women's tournament into that. And then in the previous years, in March, we've always run a women's tournament, and then I just started 2 years ago a 40 and over Alaska Native men's tournament to incorporate with the women's tournament. To me, it's like a family gathering. It's like a once a year thing where you don't see people for extended periods of time, then all of a sudden, 1 week out of the year, everybody comes together. It's friendship, family, and you treat your family like friends, your friends like family. That's all I can say.
Earlier in the girls' tournament, Minto defeated Doyon Drilling. Doyon battled through the loser's bracket to get a rematch with Minto in the championship game, where we pick up the action. For most of the first half, both teams were determined to bring home the hardware, with superb ball handling and accurate shooting.
Here in Fairbanks, Alaska, we'll be talking with Keith Gordioff of A&MB basketball team. Keith, how long have you been playing basketball in Alaska?
Well, I'm 55 years old, so I've been playing ever since I was old enough to get on the courts.
A&MB team, what do you think your possibilities are of winning this tournament here?
Very good. It's a well-balanced team. We've been together for quite a while. We have, if you look through here, we have stateside Indians, we have Eskimos, we have Tlingits and Aleuts. There's a variety of native people from all over the state. I'd like to see the native people get out and support native sports. I think it's very important. They can look at our young kids here. You know, they're up and coming, and we need to have things for them to do. I'd like to see the people in the Anchorage area pull together with the regional corporations and build a gym that we can utilize not only for the AFN convention and other festivities, but also sports. It's a very part, important part of our native heritage and life.
Throughout the second half, it was a seesaw battle with Ivanov and Doyon stepping up her game. And best answering for Minto. With 8 seconds left to go, Doyon misses the chance to put the game away. Minto, with the opportunity to win, gets the ball into the hands of Money. And best misses by inches. Wow, what a game. Congratulations to the Doyon Drilling girls and all the teams who made this tournament very exciting. Between championship games, we had the opportunity to speak with Morris Thompson, president of Doyon Regional Corporation, to get his viewpoint on the importance of sports in the Alaska Native community.
We have a lot of athletes, Native athletes in the region of Doyon. Would you like to see sports continue, and do you see a benefit of athletes and sports within the communities of the Doyon region?
Well, I think sports, of course, whether it's basketball as we're having here today, dog mushings, snowshoe racing, skiing, and alpine skiing all play a role in helping make a community healthy and keeping it healthy, because if you're in sports, you're in shape, you're working to get in better shape and be more competitive, and that's what life is all about as well. So I think sports plays a real important role in the community health throughout our region and throughout the state for that matter. So you'll see the Doyon name on a lot of sporting activities.
So we can continue to see your support with sports within the state of Alaska and also the region of Doyon.
And we're proud of that. I think it's an important function for a corporation like Doyon, particularly a Native corporation. I think it's appropriate that we be in many of these activities as we can.
That's it from Fairbanks here at the Golden Heart Native Sports Association's basketball tournament, where we had Alaska Native Brotherhood defeating Nalato in the men's 40 and over, and in the women's division, we had Doyon Drilling defeating Minto. This is Kevin Demientieff with the Sports Edition on Heartbeat Alaska. Now back to more of our show.
Well, I hope you enjoyed today's show. It's a very special show, Heartbeat Alaska Sports Edition. It won't be this long next week, but I can guarantee you every week we'll be bringing Native sports to you. And by the way, if there are any competition sports going on in your area, let us know, won't you? Give us a call here at Heartbeat Alaska, and I'll let Kevin Demientieff know. We'll send him out there along with John Crabb. Thanks a lot for joining us. God bless you. Have a fabulous week, and join us again next week for more Heartbeat Alaska.
Share your heart, Siem, to make.